English, French, German, Russian, Greek, and Hindi. What do these languages have in common? If I told you they're all related, you might be shocked, but you also might not be, as the concept of the Indo-European languages is a quite widely known and accepted theory nowadays. These languages all descend from a common ancestor, spoken by a people somewhere here-ish around 6,000 years ago-ish, before spreading throughout Europe and southwestern Asia. But how did this all come to be? More specifically, how did people realize that languages as seemingly different as Irish, Albanian, and Bengali all belong in one group? This video is brought to you by World Anvil. For the uninitiated, this is a map of the Indo-European language family, a massive group containing most of the most widely spoken languages in the world, with over 40% of the world's population speaking an Indo-European language. Wait, really? I thought it'd be higher than that. Within the family, you might have heard of a lot of its different branches, such as the Germanic languages, the Romance languages descended from Latin, the Celtic languages, the Baltic languages, the Slavic languages in the East, the Indo-Iranian languages in the very East, and Greek, Albanian, and Armenian, who sort of make up their own categories. But at first glance, Icelandic and Sinhala don't seem anything alike. So how did linguists put this massive family together? And how did they distinguish actual ancestral relations from loanwords and coincidences? While the family is thought to have had its beginnings as far back as 4000 BC, our story really starts with peoples from all over Europe noticing some strange commonalities between each other's languages. The Romans noticed similarities between Latin and Greek. Gerald of Wales believed Welsh, Cornish, and Breton descended from a common source. At around the same time, Icelandic scholars were picking up similarities between Icelandic and English. And, perhaps most tellingly, European travelers began to pick up on certain similarities between their native languages and the languages of India. The idea of different languages descending from some common ancestor wasn't exactly a foreign one to Christian Europe, which of course would have been familiar with the story of the Tower of Babel, where God made the humans start speaking hundreds of different languages so they would stay off his lawn. I personally like the XKCD interpretation a lot more, but I digress. Medieval theologists and early linguists had many candidates for what the original language of humanity was, with the most popular candidate being Hebrew. Joseph Scaliger, a Franco-Italian theologist and classicist, was one of the first to challenge this notion, categorizing the Romance, Slavic, Germanic, and Hellenic languages into their own categories, using their words for God as the basis. A few decades later, with the scientific revolution going into full swing, Marcus van Boxhorn added to this idea, proposing that Dutch, German, Latin, Greek, Persian, and the Slavic, Celtic, and Baltic languages must have descended from some common ancestor, which he called Scythian. William Jones, a British philologist, echoed a similar sentiment in a speech to the Royal Asiatic Society in 1786, suggesting Latin, Greek, Sanskrit, Persian, the Germanic and Celtic languages, as well as Egyptian, Chinese, and Japanese, all shared a common ancestor, arguably kickstarting wider interest in the hypothesis. Now, those last three additions turned out to be completely wrong, but you can't assemble a language family without making some mistakes. Lord knows people are still trying to figure out whatever Basque is up to. You do you, Basque, you pre-Indo-European gem. Over the 19th century, more and more early linguists would throw their hats into the ring, tacking on more families, proving that others like Hungarian and Finnish, Hebrew and Arabic, and the languages of South India formed their own completely separate groups, and proposing several different names for this new family of European and Southwest Asian languages. With Scythian now being used specifically for a group of Indo-Iranian languages, other names were proposed, such as Japhetic as a counterpart to Semitic, Indo-Celtic, Aryan, before that term was co-opted by evil people, Aryo-European, Indo-Germanic, but the name that stuck ended up being Thomas Young's Indo-European. Well, except for the Germans, who mostly stuck with the Indo-Germanischen. But how do you determine whether two languages are truly related? It's not just comparing any random set of words, as those could be loanwords or false cognates, or even people from vastly different groups living in close proximity to one another using similar words for the things they all use and encounter. This last one is known by linguists as a Sprachbund, and is the most likely explanation for the Altaic theory, a very controversial proposed superfamily between the Turkic, Mongolic, and Tungusic languages, with Japanese and Korean sometimes also included. However, in more recent decades, linguists seem to agree that any similarities between these languages is more likely due to centuries of common contact between these cultures rather than actually sharing a common ancestor. Language families are about revealing which languages evolved from a common ancestor, which is why English is, and always will be, considered a Germanic language. Even if, like half the English dictionary comes from French and Latin, it still evolved from a Germanic ancestor. So essentially, I've just been talking about the history of history. But if you want to see whether two languages do indeed share a common ancestor, your best starting point is going to be comparing some of the most basic everyday words, the kinds used so often for such universal concepts that few communities ever find a need to borrow a foreign term for them. This is the comparative method, literally just looking at a bunch of these basic words and finding so many similarities that there's no way it could be a coincidence. The comparative method isn't just about comparing similar sounding words across related languages though, but looking at how a set of words might have changed over time and finding patterns in those changes. As an example, let's count to 5 in English, Italian, Russian, and Farsi. And just as a control for our little experiment, let's also put in Arabic, just so we can see what's actually an ancestral relation and not just a sequence of sounds that humans are biologically programmed to associate with the number 4 or anything like that. Which isn't a thing. You can use whatever words for numbers you want in your fantasy conlangs. No, don't worry, you come later. Now take a close look at these words, and you might notice some patterns, like the words for 2 and 3 sounding kind of similar. Or maybe even a correlation between Italian's quattro, Russian's četiri, and Farsi's čahar. But there's something else going on with the words for 5, specifically with which letter starts off the word. If you think it should start with a k sound, or a similar s or ch sound in some cases, you are probably a Romance language, descending from Latin quinque, or maybe even a Celtic language, other than Welsh. If you say f this, you are probably a Germanic language. Meanwhile, if you think p, well, then you could be Indo-Iranian, you can be Slavic, you could be Hellenic or Albanian, really most of the rest of the family. As linguists tend to adopt a majority rules kind of attitude, it's easier to assume the Platonic ideal of an Indo-European 5 must have started with a p sound, and that the Germanic languages changed that to a f, while the Celtic and Romance languages went to a k. To summarize a lot of finicky nerd talk, this is how linguists decided that all these words might have descended from a common ancestor that sounded like Penque. Rest in peace, Plato. You would have loved historical linguistics. Keep in mind, though, it's not just about comparing how a word changed, but also if the meaning of that word changed as well. Take the word for the sweet, sticky substance that bees make out of nectar, Spanish miel, Greek meli, Russian mied, and English seems like an outlier with its honey. But it still fits into this pattern once you use that honey to make an alcoholic drink, which we call mead. In a way though, linguists got kind of lucky with Indo-European, as most Indo-European languages tend to have been written down for thousands of years, making for a lot less guesswork in trying to figure out what the ancestor of Catalan and Sardinian probably looked like. I mean, it's right there, on that big massive monument still standing to this day. By the time any Indo-European languages were being written down in the 2nd millennium BC, the family had already diverged quite a bit. So how do we figure out what the true OG of Indo-European languages looked and sounded like? Throughout the latter half of the 19th century, early linguists began to use some of these tools and techniques to imagine what the ancestor of all these languages would have been like. With Grimm's Law and Werner's Law detailing how sounds may change over time, particularly in the case of the Germanic languages, the first reconstructions of a possible Proto-Indo-European could be created, such as this excerpt known as Schleicher's Fable, which has been steadily updated over the years. Feel free to pause right here if you want to read through it. Around the turn of the 20th century, two other important branches were tacked onto the Indo-European family. Through the clever tactic of being extinct, the Anatolian and Tocharian languages act almost like linguistic time capsules, in turn helping add and prune select features from the sort of conlang we know as Proto-Indo-European. Let's finish this off with a very brief overview of what hundreds of years of linguistic research has allowed us to piece together about this language family. Somewhere around southern Russia and Ukraine, or maybe Anatolia, around 6,000 years ago, there lived a group of people. We know next to nothing about these people, hence how we have to call them by this clinical scientific term, and yet they would live on through one of the strongest legacies in recent human history. According to the still controversial Kurgan hypothesis though, these people were probably the Yamnaya culture, who spent 700 years spreading all around the Black Sea. and through gradual migration into new lands, their language was slowly split into several different dialects. For this, they had a secret weapon. You see those big animals running around all over the place? Turns out you can get them to carry stuff on their backs, including humans if you're so inclined. I don't know, I'll wait to see if these carriageless horses actually catch on, or if they're just a fad of the 34th century BC. The first such offshoot arose in Anatolia and the Balkans circa 3400 BC, giving rise to the Anatolian languages, among whose ranks would eventually include Hittite, but that's still 2000 years ahead of us. By the early 3rd millennium BC, later dialects of what we call Proto-Indo-European had begun to split into a Balto-Slavic and a Paleo-Balkan in the west, and an early form of Indo-Iranian in Central Asia. The last branch off of Proto-Indo-European would migrate eastward into an area known as the Tarim Basin, forming the Turkarian languages, lasting until as recently as the 9th century, and likely influencing the Chinese words for honey, leather, and cart. By the time the Hittites were fighting the Egyptian New Kingdom, we begin to see more languages emerge, such as Proto-Greek and Proto-Armenian. Italo-Celtic, meanwhile, was probably also a branch that split off around this time, later splitting off into the Celtic languages of Central Europe and the Italic languages of Italy, most notably Latin, though most notably in the sense that it's the only Italic language that actually survived antiquity, leaving its descendants to branch off into the Romance languages. This is at least part of the reason why people who speak Spanish, Italian, Romanian, or Sicilian are much more likely to understand each other than speakers of English, German, or Swedish would be.
And finally, at around the same time Rome was making Latin dominant across the Italian peninsula, Proto-Germanic would develop around the North and Baltic Seas, splitting off into a northern, western, and eastern branch, with the northern branch giving us Norse and all its northerly descendants, the western branch giving us the non-Scandinavian Germanic languages like English and German, and the eastern branch going extinct by the Middle Ages.
The thing is, of course, this isn't necessarily what actually happened, but what a bunch of the smartest minds with an interest in linguistics have been able to come up with regarding the origins of this surprisingly interconnected family. And in some decades' time, maybe this will all be disproven entirely by some other discovery. Such is the beauty of the scientific method. Science never takes things for granted the way they are, but urges those who partake in it to question their assumptions and always dig deeper, for there's always something more to find just a little further down.
One person who lived at the tail end of this boom in linguistic discovery was J.R.R. Tolkien. Just as the Proto-Indo-European Penque morphed into the Proto-Germanic Fimph and the Latin Quinque, so too did Tolkien have the initial Elvish word Quendi transform into the Avari Kindi and the Teleri Pendi. Tolkien was an absolute fanatic for languages and worldbuilding, and if you're anything like me, you might be able to relate. Which is why I'm so glad to be sponsored by World Anvil. Whether you're a writer, running your own Dungeons & Dragons campaign, or just love the act of worldbuilding, World Anvil is a platform that allows you to construct your own worlds in a dedicated place, from the most fundamental aspects of the universe to the tiniest species of space beetle. I actually reached out to World Anvil to sponsor one of my videos, because I've actually been using it, like subscription and all, for all my various worldbuilding ideas and projects, including my somehow still in progress sci-fi project Celestium. Yeah, I think I just ought to accept that I'm kind of a slow writer. World Anvil provides you with all the tools you need, from templates to character builders to places to write your stories, to family trees to timelines to mapping tools, or even my personal favorite, maps and timelines, which World Anvil calls Chronicles. Dungeon Masters will appreciate the sheer number of roleplay systems World Anvil supports, just as writers will appreciate its writing features with drag and drop scenes, and even tools for publishing and monetization. Be the KhAnubis of your own world, and go to worldanvil.com and use code KhAnubis to get 51% off a premium subscription. And if you do, feel free to share with me what you create with World Anvil.